The Holy Ghost has come here to lead us and to guide us and to all truth. All we got to do, see, we hear the Word of God. The Word of God's supposed to produce faith in our life. Faith is a miracle power to be able then to do what God has described. Have it, just to have it. And you know, Father is easy. He is easy, okay? I mean, if you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more should your Heavenly Father give you the Holy Ghost, okay? He's easy. He's easy. You come to Father and you just say, Dad, you know, I really need, you know, I need $1 million, or you need whatever. Oh, no problem, I'll give it to you. Maybe something that you would say that is impossible, that is miraculous, that goes beyond all description, a miracle that doesn't seem to be able to happen in your life. If you just begin to step over into a relationship with Him, you come to recognize this, that Father wants to answer all of our prayers that Jesus may be glorified. We sing the song, oh, Jesus be glorified in my life. The reality of it is, the Scripture describes to us that we're supposed to ask Father whatever we desire, and He'll give it to us that the Son may be glorified through Him doing that, through Him supplying that. So I want to show you how that you hook up with the Holy Ghost. Because if you don't come into the school of the Spirit, everybody who's been born of the Spirit, you've been born from above, we say born again, but same thing, born from above. Born from above means that you're not of this world anymore. You're not so of this world anymore. Your citizenship in heaven, it's a new race. Father's our God. Somebody said, well, isn't all the people just children of God? No. Jesus said, even to the Pharisees who had the right religion, says your father's the devil, the works of the devil, your father you do. Spiritually, he was referring to, of course. But when you're born again, I mean, he says to Nicodemus comes to Jesus and says, we know that you're a prophet, teacher sent from God, for no man can do these works that you do unless God be with him. He immediately stops and says, you must be born again. You must be born from above. That which is the flesh is flesh, and that which is the spirit is spirit. And he's telling us very clearly in this revelation, unless you're born of the Spirit, you can't come into the kingdom of God. You can't see the kingdom of God. You can't relate to the kingdom of God. And being born again, you become a new creation. And this new creation is washed with the water of regeneration. And if you don't understand that, I'm quoting verses of Scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17, Titus 3, 5. I mean, I could go on telling you the Scriptures that I'm quoting, but it's going to take up more time. You know what I'm saying? So I just get right to the punchline. And let me know if I say something that is not a verse of Scripture, like just now, okay? But otherwise, just understand, I'm going to deliver you the Word, because I want to show you how to hook up with the realms of the Spirit, the realms of the anointing, with the realms of heaven by the declaration of the Word. Hallelujah. God's Word is Spirit and life. Jesus said that flesh profits nothing. It's the Spirit that makes alive. It's the Spirit that quickens. And He says, my Word is Spirit and life. It's John 6:63. I try to keep up as much as I can with that, okay? Hallelujah. Andambrosagina bata. And then in a mosete. And then a sereta kamoshi epikinasa says that in Romans 10:8, hallelujah, that the word of faith is near unto us in our heart and in our mouth. And what's going to happen is we begin to express these things in God. We begin to process through the Word of God. We don't process naturally. You were born in Western society to learn how to process through the logics of men. And that isn't too far from the logic of hell, okay? And with it, you are invaded with all of your inabilities and all of your weaknesses and all the things that you cannot do. But God gave us an opportunity to step into the mind of Christ and the mind of the Spirit. That's not esoteric. It's not some special second work of grace. It's reality given to us at the new birth. God gave us a new heart and a new spirit. You realize that from Ezekiel 36:26, Jeremiah 31:30. Then you can understand it more specifically. Hebrews 8:10, Hebrews 10:16, which all talk about the new covenant where God's written His word upon our minds and upon our heart. Wow. Huh? So that we may be able to do them. The prophet said that there was coming a new covenant where God would cause us, literally make us, hallelujah, whoo, hallelujah, to walk in His statutes and keep His commandments. Wow, I like it. Say, make me. Well, watch this. Psalms 139 says He's yoked you before and yoked you behind. Anybody knows about training oxen or training horses? You yoke a horse or an oxen from before and behind. You got them. You're going to teach them everything. You got them. And then He says, and I laid my hand upon you. Wow, that's like being a whole lot under the governorship of the Holy Ghost. He's going to live in us. He's come to dwell in us and with us. I want everybody to have that day. In that day, you should know, Jesus said, that the Father is in me and that I'm in you. That day of John chapter 14, where the Holy Ghost comes and He's with you and in you. See, what happens is we want to live a human existence and try to have it in heaven. No, no. Father wants us to live a heavenly existence. He wants us to be converted and come on over here, hallelujah, and to a realm called glory. Paul described it in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13. That we were delivered from the power of darkness and have been translated in the kingdom of the dear Son, so that we can now begin to express something like that which is the outworking of the kingdom of God. Romans 4:14-17, the kingdom of God is not in meat and drink, but in righteousness, joy, hallelujah, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, hallelujah. So somebody said, well, when can I have that? All the time. So he wants you to come into the school of the Spirit now to be led by the Holy Ghost all day long. Having now been made alive by the Holy Ghost, are you listening to me? Now what you can do is you can now move with the Holy Ghost. I want to teach you how to move with the Holy Ghost. The Holy Spirit is the teacher. He's come here to lead us and guide us in all truth. Of course, once again, trying to catch up. I don't catch you up. I don't see anybody writing them down, though. I quoted Romans 8:14-17. I quoted Galatians 5:25, and I said Romans 4:17. I just quoted some other verse of scripture that I can't even remember right now. But at any rate, I mean, if you're writing these things down, I want you to just know it's the Word of God. I try my best to just stop, write all the verses of scripture down, you know, and then just go one by one and just let everybody hear it very, very, succinctly and you know, maybe a little bit more organized. But listen, tonight my purpose is to show you how to hook up with the realm of divine glory, because the Word of God is in you and you just process by the Word of God because you study the Word of God. Father wants us to walk in faith, which is an outworking faith. Faith isn't a, people have stuck. They believe that faith is a philosophical ideology. It's the concepts of religious ideas. It's not any of those things. Faith is what Jesus Christ brought to us that produces a new creation, the miracle of salvation, a new man that gives us the divine nature, huh? A new creation. Are you with me? The new man of, are you with me? The new man of Ephesians. Does everybody understand these things? I don't want to teach over your head. You know, if the new man of Ephesians 4:24, the new creation of 2 Corinthians 5:17, where everything old is gone, now everything is of God, that kind of new man. Huh? The divine nature of 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, having escaped the corruption of that is in the world through lust. Now that we can now live in this realm where we now are developed and matured by God the Holy Ghost and give all diligence to making our calling and election sure and have all ability to do so, because He by His divine power gave us everything that we need that pertains to life and godliness. Did you know I'm still quoting scripture? I want you to learn how to do that. I want you to learn how. If you can learn how to meditate upon His Word night and day, if you learn how to understand that the realms of His Word being in us, now that we are able to receive and retain it by the power of the Holy Ghost, and the specific application by the wisdom and insight of the Holy Ghost, it is a way in which we hook up with everything that's going on in the realms of heaven. Did you know that God wants you to live in goodness all day? Have you lived in goodness all day? Ask yourself. It's the fruit of the Spirit. It's the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. As many as are led by the Spirit, literally under the control, governorship, rulership, authority of the Holy Ghost, these are the sons of God. Well, you're sons of God. Don't be left out. Don't miss out on all the benefits. Don't miss out on all the goodness if your conversation is heaven. My conversation's in heaven right now. Somebody said, I want a renewed mind. I'll tell you what a renewed mind is. It's where you process by the Word of God. It's where you believe the identity the Father has given you. It's where the Word of God is able to live in you and dwell in you. I mean, the psalmist said, the Word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against you. What great power. Well, now the Lord took it and now He's made it even greater, because now the living Word who manifests the written Word has now taken up residence inside of me, and I've been born of an incorruptible seed by the Word of God, and the Word of God dwells in me, and by the Word of God dwelling in me, I have conquered Satan and defeated him at every point. Amen. Now, there's too many verses of Scripture for me to tell you the references on, and you're not going to remember them anyways until you study. Until you just begin to meditate on the Word of God night and day, that you may do. And then literally, when you read that in Joshua chapter 1 and verse 8, you know, and I understand this. I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to tell you something that comes from diligent, continuous study of the Word of God is being taped. It can stand up against any scholar, any linguistic or scholastic analysis, because it's true. The Scripture literally says, if you recite the Word of God, it's not just meditate, it's to recite, it's to mutter, it's to mumble. I'm not going to say, if you will mumble the Word of God. I'm going to say, if you will recite the Word of God day and night, that you may observe, to do all that is written here, that you may observe, that you may acknowledge it, that you may beware of it, so that you may participate with and have all the benefits of it. Because there's another mind out here. There's another understanding out here that would impose itself upon you, and it's very tyrannical. It demands. God says, He gives us a choice to participate. He says, I want you to just offer yourself as a living sacrifice to me. It's a voluntary sacrifice. I want you to offer yourself to me as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto me, which is your reasonable service. See, I want you to move from the orphan chair to the guest of honor at the table of the Lord. Some people are still sitting in the orphan chair, all undone, just don't know who they belong to. I want you to get the Word of God into you so you begin to express the identity that He's given. He's given us a salvation that's one, that is a oneness with Him. There's no other concept of salvation. He's made a new creation that belongs to Him, that's a reproduction of Himself, Christ Jesus, the first fruits, okay? His life was like a seed that was then put into the soil of faith, sown into, as it were, into the ground, and brought forth much fruit and reproduced after its own kind. Hallelujah. Somebody said there was no guarantee that the Lord would have a harvest when He sowed Himself at Calvary's cross. Oh, yes, there was. There is the law of sowing and reaping. Hallelujah. And when you put in a seed of corn, you're going to get corn. Praise God. Amen. You do tomato. I mean, come on. And what Christ Jesus has reproduced in us is His own self, so that we may say, Christ is in me. So that we may say, Christ is in me. So when I talk about faith, when you begin to talk about faith and you process faith, it's the new creation. It's not anything else. Paul's talking in every dimension of faith. He's talking about the new creation, this one who was born of the Spirit, where the miracle power of God came over us and we became one with Him. We became intimately one with Him. And now He wants to be able to have a relationship with us, and has ordained such a relationship with us that whatever we ask Him, He will do it. But I want you to understand, you're going to have to move past the limitations of doubt and the things that would obscure that and cloud that relationship, and start kissing Him more and start hugging Him more and start being able to see through Spirit knowledge Him right there with you on your right hand, that you should not be moved. Because religion is going to keep you from these things. Your integration into the world is going to keep you from these things. It's what Jesus said concerning the sower. The sower went forth to sow the seed. The seed of the Word. Some of it fell upon hard ground. And this isn't just classifications of people. This is classifications of where our lives are in many respects. And as soon as the hard ground is the wayside ground, is the beaten paths of your life, and what happens? The fowl of the air, powers of darkness, come and gobble it up before it can ever take root. Then there's the ground that has got stony ground. You know, it's not been tilled up, it's stony ground. It's lazy ground. You ain't done your work. You're sowing seed in lazy ground. You know what I'm saying to you, huh? Sow seed among rock. You're not getting any harvest. It's going to just, you know what? It's going to get burned up because it's not going to have any root. And then sowing seed among thorns. What an idiotic thing to do. Are you listening to me? And then the Lord goes and describes that, and He tells us that, and especially when you look at the thorny ground, You look at the teared ground. You look at the thorny ground. He tells exactly what it is. He says, you convoluted, you conflicted yourself. You messed yourself up. What you did was you integrated the heavenly call that I have for you and the life that I've given you with the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches and the pleasures that are around you, and so that you can bring forth no fruit unto perfection, which the Word produces. And what fruit are we talking about? Fruit of relationship. The fruit that God said in John 15:16 that He's ordained that you and I step into, that whatever we ask the Father, He'll do it. I know, man, I can tell you miracle stories. I can tell you witnesses of these things, both in the Word of God and in the practical application of testimonies that have been handed down to us for 1971 years. Where these things were living realities in people's life. And they live in reality right now. It's just that you got to change, and you're going to have to stop doing a lot of stuff you're doing. I know, praise God, you're not smoking dope anymore and drinking booze and doing partying. But you know what? There's a lot of other things you need to quit doing too. There's a lot of the concerns of the world that you're still all wrapped up in. You're going to have to say, look, I'm gonna walk away from that stuff too. I'm going to come over here and understand how to live in goodness all day. Okay? See, the Lord's called us to live in faith, expectation, and love. 1 Corinthians 13:13. Huh? We make it into religious ideas, but no. Faith, supernatural faith. Say to the mountain, get out of the way. Huh? That's relationship. That's power. That's the power of God's spoken word coming forth from you. He, with His word, created all the heavens. There's nothing that connects us with Him like His word. Nothing. Everything that the Holy Spirit is going to be teaching us, every way we're supposed to pray, everything we're supposed to believe, comes right from His word. Every miracle, beginning with the miracle of salvation, comes from His word, because we believe that if we call upon the name of Jesus Christ, that the name of Jesus has such miracle power. If I could get all of you to learn, just do a message and title it, The Miracle Power in the Name of Jesus. And just take verses of Scripture like Acts 16:31. If you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you shall be saved. And then the power of His name that has been exalted above every principality and power and might. The name is highly exalted above every name, that at the name of Jesus. I mean, think about that. You just take that message, a miracle message of Jesus, and you get it down where you can preach it. All of a sudden, when you can preach it, when you can teach it, suddenly you know it like you never knew it before. All of a sudden you go, wow, man, this is what I got. This is what the Lord's done for me. Now the word's now starting to work mightily in you. Hey, now the word of God's starting to work effectually in you. Hallelujah. Because it's more than just a casual encounter with the preacher who's just telling you so much information you can't possibly remember anything hardly he said. It's a good thing that the Holy Ghost is here tonight to bring these things into your remembrance, because I'm telling you right now, I'm speaking spirit and life to you that bypasses all your intellect. And praise God, you're not saved on the basis of how smart you are, what your IQ is. God's not even into that. This is a heart thing that God miraculously and supernaturally does for us, and He speaks right into that realm. And that's why I can and speak right to your spirit and have an impact on you, especially when you need to be healed. That's when people really see it. I mean, I love that. I love people don't know the things about the expressions of the Holy Ghost. It's foolishness to them. They don't see why it matters, what value is there in joy, rolling on the floor and laughing. Well, just wait till you're real sad you can't get out of it. Then you're going to understand what value there is into understanding how to hook up with joy at any time. What happens when people get laid out in a piece that passes understanding, they can't even blink, you know? And then people go, wait, what's the value to that? Looks weird. Just wait until the time that all of a sudden you're so overwhelmed with fear and doubt and unbelief, and you know how immediately to access the realms of peace. I mean, listen, you can either walk after the realms of human ability and after the realms of flesh, or you can come on over here and have yourself a good time in the Holy Ghost. You can either walk in an earthly realm or be blessed with all blessings in the spiritual realm in a heavenly place. You can either take your seat among all the rest of the defeated foes, or you can be seated with Him in a heavenly realm in Christ Jesus right now. It's all the basis of the Word. It's how you think. It's how you think. And the Word of God teaches us how to think just like God, because it's His Word. It's His thoughts expressed in these words. Hallelujah. There's no greater way. Faith comes by hearing the Word. The Spirit kind of Word. The Spirit kind of knowledge, hearing the Word in a way that no one else could understand or hear it. The natural mind, the unregenerated mind of 1 Corinthians chapter 2, can't hear it this way. Tonight you can hear it away. Maybe you don't hardly remember anything I'm saying. Huh? Maybe it's hard for you to remember what I'm saying, but you're getting it. Believe me, you're being changed, because the Word will transform you. The seed of the Word of God produces a miracle. Hallelujah. You can just sit there like with a blank stare and just look at me like, and you're going to be changed by the Word of God. It's going to be on you if you will begin to apply yourself. Father wants there to be the outworking of faith. He wants there to be outworking of expectation. I know people said, oh, well, it says hope. Well, do you know what hope means? Do you know what elpsis means? Do you understand how it was used in the Septuagint and the related word to the Hebrew language? Now you understand its expectation, correct? Huh? If you come into the doctor walks into the office, if Dr. Stu walks in and says, I hope you get better, you're going to go, well, what's wrong, doc? It ain't going to give you much confidence, is it? Is it? But he says, I expect you to be out of here by in the next few minutes. You're like, whoo, where's my clothes? Huh? I expect that, I'm confident that you're going to recover. Well, can I leave now? Right? That's what else this means. Huh? You're not stuck in some kind of well of hope, waiting for a rope to be tossed to you. Huh? You're in expectation. Faith has expectation. It has confidence. I'm in expectation. Now abides faith, expectation and love. And when we talk about love, we're not talking about any kind of love. We're talking about the very love of God. We're talking about supernatural love, love that is supplied by the Holy Ghost, love that fulfills all the law and all the commandments. We're talking about the love, the kind of love that if you dwell in this love, you dwell in God. We're talking about the love. If you know the love, it has gives you the access into all the fullness of God. I mean, look how easy that is. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge and thereby be filled with all the fullness of God. So just go ahead and know the love of Christ and step into the fullness of God and enjoy. And you will look at it like a cow staring at a new gate. It's because it just does it. Wait a minute, is it that easy? It's just as easy to call upon the name of Jesus. It's just as easy to interpret tongues as it is to receive them. Yeah, it's just easy to give a word of knowledge as there is to as there is for you to recall something in your math class. In fact, it's easier than that. You don't even have to think about it. All you got to do is be moving with the Holy Ghost. If you're not moving with the Holy Ghost, then it's hard, it's difficult, it's just impossible. Can't do that. Huh? Praise God. Hallelujah. Did you know that you actually wear on your face your worries, your concerns, your issues, the things that are painful to you, that are hurtful to you? Wear them on your face. What if you were delivered from all that and all you wore on your face was goodness? You touch the world. I mean, you wear on your face peace that passes understanding. I mean, think about it. This is the fruits of the Spirit. This is evidence that you're moving with the Holy Ghost, that He's here and that you're recognizing and that you're allowing it. The Lord didn't give you a little. He gave you a river full. I said He didn't give you a little. He gave you a river. He didn't give you a little. He gave you a river. Jesus said concerning these things, if any man's thirsty, come, drink. I'll give you to drink. Out of your belly shall flow rivers. Yeah. Not a little, rivers. There's a wellspring springing up continually. Keeps me from ever being thirsty for anything else. I'm not thirsty. Huh? I'm not thirsty for the lust of the flesh. I'm not thirsty for the pride of life. I'm not thirsty for the lust of the eye. I'm sitting here drinking of the well of salvation. I'm singing, I'm over here in the pleasures. I'm over here in exalted pleasure. In His presence is fullness of joy. His right hand is exalted pleasures. See, pleasures that people don't know about. What people know about is the pleasures of destruction. Pleasures of destruction, for the wages of sin is death. They know about the pleasures of destruction, the temporal things that always have chaos associated with them. Very few people know about the pleasures forevermore. See, there's a pleasure realm of heaven. There's an eternal pleasure realm. That you're going to have to go ahead, get up here in the Holy Ghost. You know, if you're sad and upset and a comedian comes along, starts telling something funny, just kind of, I don't want to get into that, but you know what I mean? You start laughing. What happened? A comedian come and access some joy, didn't he? And he just stuck the funny bone or whatever, right? Would you please logically explain to me most of how that works? Because you can't. You know you can't. Just struck you funny. Right? Some people laugh at jokes. British jokes? I mean, the British are laughing their heads off. And I'm like, what? It don't make any sense to me, But what I'm trying to get at is the Holy Ghost can access something that the comedian can't, that you can't access because you couldn't access it. Otherwise, you're so sad. And you hear something funny. It accesses joy. You get happy, right? Because you couldn't access it. You need somebody else to come access it for you. Holy Ghost can access a deep realm of joy that you can't even imagine. And when you begin to function there, you find a river. You find the glory realm. You find a wellspring. It causes you not to be thirsty for anything else anymore. You thirst for Him forevermore. He said, forevermore, give me this water to drink. Hallelujah. Ooh, Rabbi. The rivers of His pleasure. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so I just wanted you to understand that the vehicle by which that comes is the Word. And you're going to have to give yourself to the study of the Word. And when we talk about 1 Corinthians 13:13, now abides faith, now abides confidence, now abides love. Those things are only fueled by the Holy Ghost through you and I being willing to give ourselves to all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost with thanksgiving. People don't understand. That's supposed to be a place where you enjoying His presence. Not just yoked down, feeling like, it's not Gethsemane. I mean, maybe the Lord would put a Gethsemane burden upon you, an agony of Gethsemane, but there's going to be a Pentecostal joy soon to follow. Are you listening to me? Yes. And nobody likes to sit around listening to somebody praying in the agony of Gethsemane. Are you listening to me? That's not a prayer meeting that's enjoyable to be around. But and I'm not saying that the Lord doesn't put those kinds of burden on people, because he's put those kinds of burden on me. But praise God, he usually does it in a secret place where nobody can see that. Huh? And out here we just enjoy unspeakable, and usually it's enjoy unspeakable, and that's the way it's supposed to be, because if you've never understood how to enjoy the beauty and splendor of his presence, all the rest of it's really not true. It's meaningless, because Father gives to us all that he has for us to do through his abundant life. It's an abundance of life. See, when you say abundant life, that means there's so much life you can't really tell you what it means. Huh? There's abundant life, you so much life we can't really express it. So you just say it's abounding life. You were to use the word abounding or abundant, which means to have more than, it's more than enough, it's beyond all that you could express. It's super abounding. Unto him, and I can say, it's like this, it's like unto him who is able to do super abundantly above all that you could think or ask according to the power that is working in you. Wait a minute. I don't want you to do super abundantly more than I can think or ask according to something that's on the inside of me. I want you to come down here right now and stand here and take me by the hand, walk me through this process. And God says, no, that's not the way it works. I'm not going to take you by the hand and when I led you up out of each land of beach. I'm going to live on the inside of you. I'm going to show you how to relate to me in a way that goes beyond all of that. But we don't want that. Huh? Many of us, we don't want, especially at the beginning. Take me by the hand. Come here, let me see you. Now, he's put something on the inside of us. The new man, the new creation. His word, born of an incorruptible seed, but the word of God which lives and abides forever. Think about it. The living word is taking up residence on the inside of me. That, you have to pierce a wall of unbelief to get into that realm. Because it's like, wait. No, that's esoteric, that's mystical, that's not real, that's like positional, but not practical. No, real. Practical, not esoteric, reality. He's in me, living in me, walking in me. I'm the temple of the Holy Ghost. Yeah. God took the holies of holies and moved it into my heart. Uh-oh. What? Yeah. What were you going to do? You go back in Romans chapter 10. Who shall ascend and bring him down? Who shall descend and bring him up? Who shall say? Don't say in your hearts who shall go find God and bring him here. Huh? What are you supposed to say? What are you supposed to say? Verse 8 is what you're supposed to say. But if you don't know what verse 8 is, you don't know what to say. So if you don't know what to say, you don't know what to expect next. If you don't know what to say, if you don't know what God's made available, you don't know what the Holy Ghost is going to do. And if you don't know what the Holy Ghost is going to do, how are you going to do it with him? The Word of God connects you to the prosperity and the blessings and the provision that he's poured out upon us that so many people live without. He's made salvation so easy. My grandmother, I love to tell about my grandmother. Her daddy was a preacher, and she read the Bible the first time when she was 10 years old. She was going in a covered wagon from Tennessee to Michigan. But when she's 82 years old, I'm going to University of West Florida, and just before I come out here, my grandmother comes out of the back of her bedroom, out of the back of the house, because I was living with her for a time. Oh, healing is for today. Healing is for today. I was trying to watch the news. I'm like, what? Healing is for today. I said, no kidding. Dad's been telling you that for years. And I said, so what's up? She said, 82 years old. She said, well, Lord, if healing is for today, it took you 72 years. If healing really is for today, it took her 72 years to ask. If healing is really for today, she was in pain, heal me now. She got totally healed. Now she's like all excited. Healing is for today. She spent 72 years living without the blessings of God, that if she would have just known the word and believed the word, she could have had all the time. People live short of the blessings and short of all the provision and short of all the things. They live far, far beneath of all that God has provided for us in Christ Jesus, because he's not withheld any good thing from us. I mean, he's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. People say, oh, you know, you got to sin more or less every day because it's just so good. Well, let me tell you. That's not what they say. And they say, well, we sin more or less every day, and they leave it there. But they're just saying because it's just so good. I mean, because you've got to be doing something you don't like. Are you with me? Hello. Because they, why? Because they just never understood how good it is to live in the realms of God, and how greater God is than the powers of darkness, and how more effective what Jesus did for us is than what Adam did against us. Hello, we make devil bigger, Adam sin. Devil's bigger than God, Adam's sin's better, bigger than Jesus' obedience. It's not true. The Bible doesn't say that. But if you don't know the Word of God, you perish for lack of knowledge. You go without. You live destitute. You live orphaned. Because God, the Holy Ghost, has come to lead us and guide us into all truth, but He's not going to lead us and guide us into our imaginations of the truth. And He's not going to come and download the entire New Testament for us aside from the Bible, picking it up and reading it. If you just begin to give yourself to the Word, well, we're giving yourself to the Word is so easy. And then you begin to let God, the Holy Ghost, begin. And if you just are really, 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 really lazy and extremely slothful, you could get through the Bible in a year, reading three chapters a day. Three chapters a day. Just three little chapters a day. And if you read slower than Elmer Thud, you can get that done in 8 minutes to 10 minutes. Are you with me? And people just procrastinate and they don't do it, and they're nothing about diligent, and they don't understand that God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him, and they don't understand about give all diligence to make your calling, election sure. Diligence just doesn't come to play in their life. And so thus they live outside of all the blessings and benefits because they perish for lack of knowledge. They just don't know. But what happens if you just begin to know and you become like a little child and you become converted and become like a little child and everything Father says and all of His promises that He declared are yours? Yeah. Huh? Yeah. Whatever Father promised. Just like He told Sarah, He returned unto her and He gave her a child even as He promised her. Yeah. And that's from Genesis, that's Genesis chapter 21. It's the same way all the way through. And of course, such visitations from the Lord and promises and His fulfillment of His promises are repeated over and over again, even before that. There's two great cloud of witnesses concerning this, but we get, what happens is that we perish for lack of knowledge, we don't know the Word of God, or we allow things that we see and hear around us to become bigger than the Word of God. I was ministering to a person who had a disease, a sickness, a problem, a physical pain in their body, preacher, okay? And as I began to minister to them, I was addressing it. I addressed, and now from a physiological point of view, if you went in and did an MRI and structural analysis of the physiology of your body, we'd have some brilliant guy come along and tell you exactly what's going on, how he's going to fix it, but he can't most of the time. We'll give him 15% success rate. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
But I'm going, I'm Bastagi in the midst of the day, I put it that. In Jesus' name, and all of a sudden, the thing starts manifesting. It starts doing all kinds of crazy stuff. It's like, what is that? Yeah, that's the spirit of pain. That's not logical to me. Well, let me help you. I'm going to try to get you out of all this stuff that's logical, but I want to set this up for you, because I want you to live by the Word, okay? The unregenerated mind is talked about, for example, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and verse 14, the natural man cannot receive the things of God because they're foolishness. Everybody knows that one, right? And of course, there's a whole lot more to say there, because I don't like to focus on that part. Anytime I think about 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, I got to think over here about verses 9 and 10, that we are now able to see what eyes never seen before, that which eyes not seen, ears not heard, neither is it in the heart of men. Those things which God has prepared for them that love Him, but He has now revealed them to us by His Spirit. However, the natural mind, the unregenerated mind, the mind that doesn't know the things of God, the carnal mind, the mind of death of Romans chapter 8 and verse 6, can't receive the things of God. Are you with me?
Yes.
But we don't have that. We have the mind of Christ, right? We have the mind of Christ. Yeah. We have the regenerated mind of Christ, which is actually that one beautiful verse right there at the end of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. What is it? Verse 18? But you have the mind of Christ. And my goodness. And we know those things which are freely given to us of Him. We have the mind of the Spirit. And we're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Jesus said, that which is the flesh is flesh, that which is the Spirit is Spirit. He says, Nicodemus, you can't come in the way you were born. You're going to have to be born again. Come on in now. Okay? So Paul takes up that theme in Romans 8, 9 and says, that which is the flesh. He says, you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Because you've been born of God. Isn't that beautiful? Huh? Okay. Now, and then somebody said, okay, I've got the mind of Christ. I've got the mind of the Spirit. I can be endued with the very person and life of Christ Jesus. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, right? Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, which is literally the same word for to be endued. To be endued with power from on high. That word, endued from power on high. Remember that word, that phrase? Luke 24:48. Remember that phrase, endued, huh? Okay, that's the same exact word that is used over here. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Be endued with the Lord Jesus Christ. Be endued with the new man. It's an event of the regeneration. It's the event of regeneration. The definition of salvation. Everybody knows it's a definition of salvation, right? Because many people don't know that it's a definition of salvation. Thus, they perish for lack of knowledge. They don't know who they belong to. They don't know that they're one with God. They don't know how to speak these things out. They don't know how to delight themselves in the Lord. They don't know how to recount all that God has done for them in the midst of their crisis. They don't know how to pray after the manner of His Word, after the Word which He's put in our mouth. One of the greatest things that you could say about the prophets, God said to Jeremiah, I put my Word in your mouth. He's put His Word in my mouth. He's put His Word in your mouth and in your heart. But you've got to know it and speak it. Because otherwise what you're going to do is you're going to speak out of the realm of human understanding. Because I want to set this up for you. Unregenerated mind, that's not you. Regenerated mind, mind of Christ, mind of Spirit. Which is what? It is the mind of thinking after what? The things of the Word of God. Because that's what the Spirit of the Lord is showing us. What's, huh? He opened up their understanding that they may know the Scriptures. Remember that? Are you with me? He gives us spirit of wisdom and revelation. You understand? He gives us this knowledge. This knowledge comes, a spirit knowledge comes from where? His Word. What did I start off saying? John 6:63. I told you didn't remember, right? Now you remember, okay? So I just bring back into context, the flesh profits nothing. My Spirit makes you alive or quickens your understanding, quickens everything is about you, makes alive, it's sharper. The Word of God can come out of your mouth as a sharp sword that divides asunder joint from marrow, thought, huh? So from spirit, and discern the thought and the intent of the heart. The living, quickening Spirit. He said, my Word is spirit and life. Spirit and life. This is the knowledge of the holy. This is the knowledge of God. When God says in Psalms, seek knowledge, Proverbs, seek knowledge, seek understanding, seek wisdom. He's talking about spirit knowledge. He's not talking about all the other knowledge, the plethora of satanic knowledge. People don't understand that. Society and the mind of the world and the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world that now works in the children of disobedience, afflicts them with a different kind of mind, unregenerated minds. Talked about in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 2 through 4. You want to understand how to be isolated from that. You want to be segregated from that. And God's segregated from this. It's called sanctification. Set apart, sanctification. Set apart, consecrated to the Word of God, to live under the Word of God, to live under a new knowledge, a new understanding, a new reality. Peter said, speak the Word only. You speak the Word, you invite me as the living Word, you speak the Word, and I'll immediately step over into a spirit knowledge. What does the spirit knowledge say? Before I was in the boat, I was afraid because of logical thinking, natural knowledge. We were about to die, we were about to drown. The wind and the waves were contrary to us. Speak the Word, what does the Word of God do? Puts me over in a realm of spirit knowledge. What does spirit knowledge allow me to do? Walk out onto the water, out onto the stormy sea. So now the wind and the waves that were threatening to me no longer have any ability to sway my emotions, my passions, my thinking, my attitudes, my appetite. Hello? Did you know salvation actually goes to your passions, your emotions, your attitude, your appetite? I'm going to tell you right now, there's a lot of people who don't even know that. People don't know that. He said that out of your kolia, which is a Greek word that means emotions or passions out of your belly. He could have used a lot of words. He could have used so many different Greek words that would relate to heart and so many other, spirit, soul, whatever. He said belly. He said kolia. He said out of your kolia, which is an Attic Greek word, which primarily, literally means passions. But God affects every part of our being. Out of your passions shall flow this unlimited expression of the very person and life of God. Hello. The goodness, the mercy, the temperance, the godliness, huh? The brotherly kindness, the joy. Hello. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to overwhelm every part, every cell in your body, every dimension of your spiritual being. I mean, you're the temple of the living God. Your body is the temple of the living God. You're supposed to glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are His. I mean, what part is He going to live out? It is a Greek mentality to dichotomize the spiritual nature of man. It's not a Hebrew concept at all. It belongs to Hellenism, and it's got a whole lot of hell in it. You with me? It's the first syllable. Don't get too sanctified. Hellenism got a lot of hell in it. There's a lot I could say there, but I'm not going to do it. I want you to get over here in the Word of God. I want you to live by the Word of God. God took them through the wilderness, took them through a hard place, took them through challenges, so that what? They may learn to do what? Live by the every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God, right? Where's that? That's Deuteronomy 8:3. Somebody said the Old Testament's not very powerful. Well, Jesus quoted that scripture and basically defeated Satan's worst. Satan mobilized everything he could possibly, don't you believe that? Satan absolutely gave his best shot. He brought all his power to bear. He brought all of his ability to bear when he came out against Jesus. And the living word destroyed him in his power and his impact by declaring what? The word that overcomes. I write unto young men, because the word of God abides in you, overcome the wicked one. You've defeated Satan at every point. Look at how the word overcomes. Now, I'm now transcend. People don't like that word, but it's a great word. I can't help it that other things want to use that word. It doesn't matter. I transcend whatever is going on that is being imposed upon me in a sensual realm into the realm in which Christ Jesus exists, in a realm called heavenly, and a realm called the realm of the Spirit, simply by his word. And I do that by saying, I live by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. I've allowed the Lord Jesus Christ to come and rule over me. The living word now rules over me. Is he ruler or is he just Lord? I haven't heard too many people singing sovereign ruler, absolutely in charge of my life, that I don't do anything because I'm a slave. But we do say Lord, and we can kind of feel it. You know what I'm saying? I'm being sarcastic, I understand. But I'm really trying to break this thing down. We're going to have to make some shifts here in the way that we think if we're going to connect with what Father has provided for us through the riches of his word, through the riches of his salvation. Listen, somebody said, I don't have enough. You have enough. His divine power has given you everything that you need according to life and godliness. He's given us everything according to his divine power. He's given us everything that we need that pertains to life and godliness so that we can live out the life of glory and virtue. So we're without excuse, people. People got all these excuses. Well, we've got to live in this world. No, you don't. God said, you're not of the world. Don't live in the world. That's what he said. See, now you're believing something different. Why? Because you heard it from a preacher and thought it was God's word. You heard it from Luther, or you heard it from Augustine, or you heard it from Jerome, or you didn't know you heard it from him, but you did, or from Clement of Alexandria, or from Tatian, or from Justin Martyr, or from Eusebius, or from so many different people we could name, who took Aristotle and put it to Christianese, like Thomas Aquinas. And I could go on. And you thought, but they don't have any scriptures. Why don't you just go ahead and wash your head, wash your thinking with the water of the word, huh? Why don't you go ahead and get washed with the water of the word, so that you can think different. See, that's what it really means to be renewed in the spirit of your mind, is to think different, to think different. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transfigured by thinking different. How do I think? I want to get transfigured. See, Jesus said, I want to go. Jesus always going off by himself to pray. To a solitary place to pray, to a mountain to pray, alone to pray, huh? And one day he took three closest, Peter, James, John, took him out on the mountain and said, you want to see what's going on? Let me show you what's happening. And he was metamorphosed to be transfigured before them. So that word is defined for us in the transfiguration. It's not defined for us in a caterpillar going from a caterpillar worm-like thing to a butterfly, and all these other little crazy little things, that nonsensical things, non-biblical things that people want to make it. That word was sanctified by its use at what we call the Mount of Transfiguration. And then it's utilized there and plugged in, not by accident, in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. It says, don't be conformed to the world. Well, we're always being conformed to the world. We're getting entertained by the world. We're hanging out with a high five in the world. You know, buddy up, buddy, you know, with the world. Well, watch out, dressing like the world, acting like the world, trying to fit into the world, trying to be accepted by the world. Are you hearing me? Yes. God said, you come out. Oh, no. I want to show you another realm. I want to show you another realm so you can deliver them out of their darkness. So he said, don't be conformed to the world, but be transfigured, metamorphosed. It's more than transformed. Because people want to use the word transformed to smack of a second work of grace, to make it a process that someday we're going to get there. But everybody who's going to get there someday never arrived. They died going to get there. Because I've been in this a long time. I've been in the church for 57 years. I was born in Caney, Kansas. Somebody said, oh, you're from Kansas. No, it was a 12-week revival. It was a 12-week revival. And that's how I, this is just how I came into this life and in this world, and praise God for it, okay? So I'm here today. And I've watched all these people going to lay aside the weight and the sin that does so easily beside them. You need to get on with the program. These people are going to come suddenly they're going to one day get there, and, you know, this great process. You know, it's like Ravenhill said, and he said it so perfectly. He said, there's no sanctification in the sepulcher. So you better get on with your process. Something's got to happen sometime. Hello. Are you with me? I've got mine free. And I can take you to the same shop I got mine. You get free too. I can take you to the same place, the same person. He's giving it for free. For free. It's a gift. It's a gift of righteousness. It's a gift of holiness. It's a gift of the new creation. It's now being sanctified in Him and by Him, sanctified by His Spirit, sanctified by the Word, sanctified by the truth, sanctified by His life, sanctified by His person. You can't get more sanctified than the Holy Ghost come take up residence on the inside of you. You can't get more sanctified than becoming a new creation. Old things pass away, behold, all things are new. You can't. You can't. Sanctification is simply the empowerment of the Holy Ghost to live the life of Jesus. That's salvation. That's all it means. Oh, if you just begin to let the Word of God rule you. God's Word, there is, the Holy Ghost will cause you to remember. He'll bring into remembrance everything He's spoken, but you're going to have to hear what He spoke first. Are you with me? Yeah, He's written His Word upon our heart and our mind. His ways, He's established in them. But we make connection with Him through the Word. We know exactly. It is not subjective. Subjective means that we can kind of feel, you know, touchy-feely our way through it and say, well, you know, I don't know if it really relates to us in 19, you know, or, well, we're not tonight, 2016. This past 16 years, I mean, it's just like been unbelievable anyways. But at any rate, Jesus, what's going on now? Okay. Because with the Father, a day is 1,000 years a day, 10,000 years, just, He feels the same way about things He did in the beginning as He does now, as He will in the end. Nothing's changed. Everything with Father is the same. So there's no subjectivity. There's no relativisms here. Well, we make relativisms. You encounter with God and all your relativism has exploded. Because now we base what's good or righteous or what's right based upon how we compare ourselves with each other and other people and other churches and other things. Huh? But all of a sudden, what Father does is He calls us to confront Him. And He is the definition of holiness. Because holiness is defined by Him and means He's separate from all other things. And He brought us into that, separate from all other things. That's the word, that means sanctification, separate from all other things. Separate. Huh? Separate where He is. He said to Abraham, He said, come out from among them and stand over here with me. Come on the other side of the flood. And thus He called him Ivrit. Ivrit. Say Ivrit. You got to catch your tongue between your teeth. Ivrit. And you'll say it right. Ivrit. Hebrew. It means Hebrew. One who stands on the other side of the flood with God. Abraham was willing. Are you willing? We have to be careful. We got to be careful. Just say, I'm willing. I'm willing. And say, okay, I want to become mindful of how to separate good from evil, light from darkness, truth from lie. Well, how am I going to do that? Word of God. His Word is a light unto our path, a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. His Word, the use of it, allows us to discern between good and evil. Without the use of it, we don't know the difference. Huh? His Word. His Word separates for us, the imposing lies and fiction and realm of men that is all around us. And so, you know, when you look, for example, in 2 Corinthians, I'm going to try to wrap this up. It's difficult for me. Somebody said it's a long-winded preacher. I learned from good examples. Paul preached all night, huh? Preaching late, huh? Young man falls down dead. I got to meet him as soon as I get to heaven. Dude, you got in the Bible, falling asleep in church. Goes down, prays for him, raises him from the dead, continues on, preaches the rest of the night, gets up the next morning, travels to the next city. See, I'll bathe myself in the Word. I'll live in the Word. Hallelujah. You want to be in here, even if I got to lock the door and force you. Now, my mom brainwashed me before I was 3 years old, I was brainwashed. Brainwashed with the Word of God, praise God. Hallelujah. Huh? I wake up in the middle of the night. Let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be holy and acceptable in thy sight, O God, my strength and my redeemer. Huh? And there, right, Geneva. Hey, just because it's just mom. Let the words of my mouth. You've got to say it again. Okay. Let the words of my mouth. Let the words of my mouth. Yes, we got to go. The meditations of my heart. Meditations of my heart. Acceptable in sight. Acceptable in thy sight. Oh, Lord. My strength and my redeemer, my strength and my redeemer. Okay, say it again. Thanks, Mom. Yes. Can you hear me? Because now I can step over into 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, and understand what I'm supposed to be doing. Because there it says, you know, it says, of course, the Lord tells us, he says in verse 4, weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're God power. Or as you read in King James, mighty through God, right? What to do? What to pull down? What to pull down? What to pull down, and to bring into captivity? What? Huh? To cast down? To cast down? And really, there's a connectivity between all of those, and especially it's emphasized in the particular word of imaginations. Because that's a wrong. It's not a proper way to translate the word logisismos. Logisismos. It literally is the word from which we derive logic. It's rational thinking. You need that to drive home. Okay? But you can't use that for walking on the water. You can't use that for walking in the Spirit. You can't use that to take hold of the miracle realm, to live in the faith realm, to have all the things that God said He's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. Strongholds. We're not talking about unregenerated mind. We're talking about the things that are imposed upon us by the world around us. The God of this world, the prince of the power of the earth, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, all those things that belong to the world that are not of the Father and that are not in us. Did you know that there are many people that believe all that stuff is in them? They've got some root of iniquity. Iniquity that they're going to try to have to, you know, dig in there and get it out. That's painful. But you can't get it done because there's no word. There's no word of authority to get it done. And if you don't have the word, the miracle word of authority, then the miracle faith isn't going to work. So as long as you believe there's something going on that you've somehow got to take care of, that God saved your spirit, but your body and soul's yours to deal with. You only did one third, Lord, and you left two thirds for me? Well, that's, of course, not the word of God. Those concepts don't even exist within the Hebrew mentality. It doesn't even exist within the Word of God. It's something that's, once again, purely Hellenistic. It's something that belongs to ideology and philosophy and traditions of men that spoil you after the rudiments of the world instead of build you up in the knowledge of Christ Jesus. It's just the facts. It's just the plain truth. Because I'm going to tell you right now, look at somebody who lives in the glory and the freedom and the splendor and the beauty and the liberty of the truth. The truth has set them free to live in the Word of God. And compare them to a pair of people who basically are living supposedly the Christian life, but that you would do good to get three verses of Scripture out of them. Do you know three verses of Scripture? Yeah, let me think. Jesus wept. They remember that one from, you know, Sunday school. Right? They got the candy bar for it or whatever. There's only two words. I'm sorry. I'm not being sarcastic. I'm trying to make a point. I'm just trying to make a point because we got all of these models and examples that are false models and false examples. We got to understand that the Lord has given us power because He wants us to fundamentally live in the knowledge of God. All these things are opposed to the knowledge of God. It's not an unregenerated, unredeemed mind. Because if it is, then you're in serious problem. If you believe you've been born again and made a new creation and you still got an unregenerated mind, I have no solutions for you. Because I process by the Word of God and there is nothing in the Word of God that can help you. There's no way to fix you. You've got to get yourself a regenerated mind when you get born again. You can't, it's like somebody walking around looking for their head. Are you listening to me? It's just how messed up that concept is. Hello. And it's all about the word of the knowledge of God to bring into captivity every thought, to cast down every imagination, to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, to live out. Look at this. I want you to look at this with me real quickly, because it's just, I'm going to end with this verse of scripture. I believe. I'm not going to tell the Holy Ghost what to do. But a sukiya namashi. Did I not sabina? Somebody said, what's the good of that? That's how the Holy Ghost taught me how to talk. That's how the Holy Spirit taught me how to speak, how to move in the word of knowledge, how to move in miracles. Somebody said, well, in the Old Testament, they didn't speak in tongues and they did word of knowledge and miracles. Hello, newsflash. This isn't the Old Testament. This is the New Testament. Hallelujah. It's a whole new system of living. Amen. And now, especially for somebody on the web, I'm sure, or YouTube. I love the web and the YouTube. You get to preach while you're sleeping. Praise God. Thank you, guys. 159 nations last year. Come on, man. We're just going to make it something even more. Hallelujah. You know, just come on, people. Just learn how to just, and I pray that every one of you do this. Learn how to just take a theme and begin, and just take a theme, anything. Take Holy Ghost theme. Take your, better than that, I was going to say take a highlighter. Take Holy Ghost theme on your computer. Take all the verses of Scripture. Bring them over a piece of paper. And now, when you go to your prayer time, just start thanking the Lord. Put them in first person and just begin to thank the Lord, like, let's just say, for the Holy Ghost. Just thank the Lord for the Holy Ghost, reading the verse of Scripture as it directly applies to you. I'm going to tell you right now, your prayer life will go to a whole other dimension. You won't be praying a bunch of doubt and unbelief, a bunch of thinking of men and understanding of men. Now you're going to start speaking out of the realms of the Spirit knowledge and get trained in Spirit knowledge. We in the school of the Spirit, but somebody's going to have to come and learn. I mean, come on. Come on. Huh? There's certain, I like to use this example. There are certain problems that you're going to only really be able to solve if you understand how to think in terms of quantum mechanics or quantum logic. Okay? Certain math equations, certain problems. It's a different kind of way of thinking. And you don't get that overnight. It is a very difficult way to learn to think. You begin to take on these various different disciplines like physical chemistry, which only three people in the world really understand, and they died. But nonetheless, I mean, we spend a lot of time trying to get that. We still, you know what I'm saying? And people give themselves earnestly to it. But there's another realm of knowledge. If we want to work in it, if we function in it, we've got to learn how to cooperate. We've got to learn how to think differently. And that's going to be by application, where you, like in Proverbs chapter 2, it begins to explode to you and on the inside of you, where you begin to go after these things more than silver, more than gold, more than anything else that can be desired. You're laying hold of knowledge. You want understanding. Then God says you're going to find the knowledge of the holy. But we just act like it's just going to come somehow by osmosis or, you know, passive diffusion or, you know, when I was little and I'd come into my mother's room and say, I had a bad dream. Can I sleep with you? She said, no, here, take the Bible, put it on each pillow, and you'll be fine. And that worked good for me when I was 3 and 4 years old. But then I had to open it for it to continue to work. It worked good because it was her faith anyway. I was just obeying the prophet. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. So look at that verse of Scripture with me, because it's really a big part of what you're dealing with. I'm just telling you right now, you're thinking wrong. You get a problem? You're thinking wrong. You don't have enough problems. You don't have all the solutions. You got lack? You're thinking wrong. The Lord is your shepherd and you have no lack. You're thinking wrong. I mean, come on. I mean, you got to start thinking right. Hello! You're going to have to start living by the Word and speaking the Word. If you want to be successful, to be bold and confident and successful and inherit all of the things that God has given to us, then you're going to have to recite the Word of God. So you're reciting the Word of God so that you remember to do what? Do it. Recite it day and night that you may do according to everything that is written. Then shall you make your way prosperous and you shall have great success or good success. Joshua 1:8. Please, just Start praying like this. Start connecting with the Word of God. I mean, you begin to enjoy the room. Your life will become filled with His presence. You begin to enjoy His presence. When you begin to hook up with the beauty of His presence, you begin to enjoy the beauty of the Lord. Then you start hearing from heaven. Things get good and you like prayer. And it's not boring and hard and tough and weird. And that's just the beginning. That's just the beginning. You start letting God use you. You start beginning to obey Him and do the things He's called you to do. And you'll begin to have physical manifestations of all sorts and kinds. Because the spirit world is more real than the physical one you're looking at. This one's temporal. That one's eternal. This one, it is bogged down with all kinds of illusions and deceptions. That one, there's nothing but truth and reality. Huh? This is death. And that's life and peace. Therefore, we look not on those things which are seen, but we look on those things which are, see, to look upon. There's where our affections and our desires are. We're risen with Christ. Set your affections upon things above, not on things of this earth. And that's the big problem. We don't know how to do that. We don't know how to make that transition because we don't process with the Word of God that allows us to think different about ourselves. But if we're there now thinking different about ourselves, we'll be transfigured. Just like Jesus was transfigured. Yeah. Huh? You begin to, my. I'm just about to have a drunk session right now. I'm just about, see, Paul said, I'm sober for your sake. Otherwise, I'm beside myself. And a lot of that is because we go over into another glorious realm. The beautiful thing about that glorious realm, it's full of joy, it's full of peace, it's full of everything that belongs to His purity, His righteousness, the kingdom of God, His righteousness, joy, and peace, and the Holy Ghost. And we become so filled up and so connected with Him, much of the physical and natural functionings begin to shut down. But you know what? you don't have a problem dealing with all of the things that Satan comes and propagates. You don't have a problem dealing with all the doubt and unbelief anymore either. It causes you to think different, function different, act different, be different. Moses got sober in that realm, his face started shining and glowing with the radiant presence of the Lord. There's times where we've been in meetings and I've looked around and I've seen people that I'm with that ministering together, people that are close with me in ministry that are traveling evangelists, and see people's face glowing. See, literally radiant glow of heaven, because they just off in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. There with the mighty host I stand. And it's now. It's a now thing. People think the kingdom of God's later. Kingdom of God's now. The kingdom of God is also later. He will come physically for all eyes to see. But we've already been born into this. Spirit, Jesus already crowned king. People think it's someday in the future. He's already king. He's already head over all principality, power, might, and dominion. Every name that is named, both not in this world, but also in the world to come. And has been, been given a name far above all principality and power. See, God wants you to have the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him so that you can understand the inheritance that He has in you. He's got an inheritance of souls in you. Signs, wonders, great glory, and things that go beyond all that we can talk about in this life, out in the future. That you may come to recognize the exceeding greatness of His power that has been given to you, vested in you, when He raised Jesus Christ from the dead and seated Him at His own right hand. Let me interject something there. That's when He poured out the Holy Ghost, praise God, upon you and me, upon all flesh, baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Just imagine, Job just had a little old hedge. We got God, the Holy Ghost, baptized in His presence, surrounded by His glory. Say, you live in that? Say, get in touch you. Sin can't touch you. Then all those scriptures about Satan can't touch you come alive. Otherwise, you're like, what is he saying over there? That must be a cult. All he does is quote the word. No, that's what it's come to. All he does is quote the word. He just quote the word. Doesn't even open his Bible. Just sit there and quote the scripture. Scripture after scripture after scripture. There's something wrong with that. That is what it's come to. We're going to have to come back over here to the word. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, look here, quickly, just try this real quickly. I want you to get this. Verse 4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Say, not carnal.
Not natural.
Not of human ability.
Not of human
reason.
Not of bootstrap salvation.
Not of a process through your own discipline. See, having begun in the Holy Ghost, are you now made perfect by your own human ability?
No.
There's no way. Having begun in the Holy Ghost, you're made perfect by the Holy Ghost. What does that mean? You fully mature, you grow, you... Hallelujah, because we're already complete in Him who is the head. Amen?
Amen.
If you acknowledge in the head. If you acknowledge the head, then you'll grow up into all things in Him. I said you'll grow up into all things in Him. Hallelujah. So for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, which literally is. And if you translate this from the Greek text, and anybody's got a Greek text here, or you're watching me on the web or YouTube, you got a Greek text, just look at it. Because it's theodunamis, which is the power, it's God power. But at any rate, so we have God power. Where's God power? Now unto Him is able to do super abundantly above all that you can think or ask according to His power that is at work on the end. Huh? What was he talking about there? Stepping in and knowing the love of Christ and stepping in all the fullness of God, knowing with all saints what is the height, the breadth, the length, the depth. Huh? And where, how are we going to know that? Because we're going to rend the heavens and come down? Rend the heavens of God and come down? He did that. You need to go back to the Old Testament. That will work back there with Isaiah. Go with Isaiah. Now get over here. He already rend the heavens. He's come down. Heavens is open. Praise God.
Praise God.
Huh? And even if they were closed, it wouldn't matter because Father, Son, and Holy Ghost living on the inside of me.
Yeah.
According to what Jesus said. Are you listening?
Yeah.
Okay. I have many more things to say unto you. But you cannot bear them. Now, so we're going to turn you over to the Holy Ghost here in just a few minutes. And you know what He's going to do? He's going to tell you, get in the Word.
Amen.
Read the Word. Let me show you the Word, the living Word. I want you to handle the Word. Hallelujah. The Spirit and Life Word. Not black ink on white paper. Not concepts and ideas. Spirit and life. Living and powerful. Hallelujah. Woo! Aha! Now, casting down logizomos, rational thinking, the logics of men, that which you spent so much money on to learn. The way everybody else tells you it's got to be, the way everybody else tells you it's got to work. No spirit knowledge to speak to the rock, say to the rock, speak. You start speaking to the rock and say, come water, and water comes out. Spirit knowledge will look at the bank account and says, money, multiply. Don't matter what the IRS says about it. Hallelujah. Huh? You just see that they... Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
No. Come on. This is a relationship realm. It doesn't come by... It's a relationship realm. It's spending time with Him. It's getting so caught away in joy unspeakable that you look like you're drunk. So caught away in peace that passes understanding that you don't even look like you hear. You could barely even speak. Hallelujah. Whew. It's coming to a place of interaction with God where you lose the... I got to be careful. Because if I talk about these things, they happen. That's why connecting with the Word of God connects you with the realms of heaven. If I talk about the Word of God and the experiences of the Word of God, it happens. So if I have to be careful... If I start talking about losing the English language on a daily basis, because if I do, I will run the very risk of ending the meeting. I was preaching the other night. Yes. In Harlingen, Texas, and I made mention of these things, and it was over. I could not come back to the English language, so I just had to sit down after a while. But people was pretty much taken over by the power of God through the process, which is a beautiful thing. There wasn't people sitting there looking, because the manifestation of the Holy Ghost So it's a wonderful thing for those who know how to receive. And there's too many people who come in part way into the kingdom of God. They don't know how to receive from the Holy Ghost. They don't know much about Him. And we're set on changing that. We're set on introducing people to the Holy Spirit. That's what Jesus did. Everything that Jesus did, He did by the Holy Ghost. Everything. He was born by the Holy Ghost. Did you know that? Matthew 1:21. I've got to be careful because I'm going to go off on this again. Huh? Mary, pregnant with Jesus, spoke to her cousin Elizabeth, and Elizabeth and John got baptized in the Holy Ghost. Jumped up with joy, rather, filled with the Spirit in her womb. John comes along saying, I baptized you with water, he baptized you with the Holy Ghost. Jesus' first three sermons were about the Holy Ghost. In fact, everything, all of his sermons were really about the Holy Ghost. He talked to Nicodemus about the Holy Ghost, John chapter 3. He talked to the woman at the well about the Holy Ghost, John chapter 4. Hallelujah. Whew. Then he goes right down into Nazareth. And it doesn't pick us up in John. You have to go over to Luke. But if you look at it from a chronological point of view, he goes to Nazareth and says, the Holy Ghost is on me. Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
And this is the only way that we're going to be able to do these things, because he is the one who brings the word to life. Did you know that? Did you know that? He's the one who brought the word and made him a holy embryo. He's the one who manifested the word. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he's the one who revealed the glory of the word. Hallelujah. Because Jesus did what he did by the working of the Holy Ghost. We understand how the God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went about doing good, healing all who were oppressed with the devil, for God was with them. That same Spirit of the Lord, Holy Ghost, was upon them because he had anointed them to preach the gospel, the good news to the poor, to bind up the broken and hearted, proclaim liberty to the captive, the open the prison doors to them that are bound, and the acceptable year of the Lord, which you're in right now, which you can get excited about because now His Spirit's been poured out upon, Holy Ghost been poured out upon all flesh. You might as well go in and enjoy it now. It is something that you can't try to do, and you can't be pressed to doing. It's something that you learn because you're in the school of the Spirit, because you walk with Him, because you yield your members to Him, as Romans chapter 6 says. You yield your emotions to Him, your passions to Him, and your emotions, your passions, they literally become weapons. Weapons of righteousness. Same word is used here in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. The weapons of our warfare is the same word that is used over there in Romans 6 for instrument. Weapons. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So I'm going to try to finish this. Casting down logics, rational thinking. It runs contrary to the word. It says, we can't do this. We can't walk on the water. We can't say to the mountain, be moved. We can't say to a sycamine tree, be plucked up by the roots and planted into the sea. We can't say that whatever we ask the Father, He'll do it. Because I remember in logical thinking and rational thinking, because Uncle Joe, who's holier than anybody else, said this and that and the other thing. Because what the Lord's talking to us about is living by the Word and connecting by the Word, connecting with Him by the Word. Casting down imaginations. Here we go. Look at here. Casting down. See it? Everybody looking at it? And every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. Every high thing. Where does that come from? It comes from all those things, all those inputs, all those influences around us. The knowledge of God is so important. You begin to learn how to just live by the knowledge of God. Listen to me. And the word of knowledge becomes so easy. You begin to learn how to live by the knowledge of God. Spirit knowledge is no problem. You find yourself and all of a sudden you're just overtaken by the Spirit of the Lord, and you speak something and a miracle happens, and it becomes every day. It becomes every day in your life. The word of faith is there because you have spirit knowledge. You're under the unction and inspiration of the Holy Ghost to speak. And bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ Jesus, to the obedience of Christ. Obeying what Jesus said, doing it His way. Hallelujah. Well, thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you. Rasati nama. I thank you for the namasetoshi. Rabokasht. I thank you for the anointing right now to where that every person in this place begins to process, think according to the Word of God, begins to pray the Word of God, speak the Word of God, live the Word of God. A process of thinking. Somebody says, can you do it? Well, let's see. John 3 says, and John, and Titus says, and God said to Moses, and God said to Paul, and that's just the way you conclude things. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.